I've been chasing it for many years. It used to belong to a vet called Morris Cook, and he was a bit difficult to find while he was on his way around the world in a Piper Cub. So finally we tracked him down and managed to persuade him to sell it. When we got to it, it was all dismantled in a barn, hanging up on walls and things, pigeons all over it, and we put it in a horse box, two trailers, brought it up, put it together, and there you see it. It's not an aeroplane you would want to go any distance in. It is difficult to fly. It's taken us 2 years to get it rigged properly, so that it'll turn both left and right. It turns quite easily to the left, but it rather doesn't like going right. But we've got it going now, so.
Contact.
Contact.
The aeroplane was built in 74 from the original drawings. It originally had a 90 horsepower engine, which is what the original aeroplane had in, and it proved nobody would fly it because it was so underpowered and it was so difficult. So they then put this Kinner engine in it, which is a 1940s American engine, and it's about 130 horsepower, which is 50% more than they had to start with, and it goes quite well with that. It's a radial engine, not a rotary engine, so the cylinder stays still, whereas in a rotary engine the propeller is bolted to the crankcase and the whole crankcase turns, so there's a huge amount of weight turning. That's the original engine, the whole thing used to turn. As you can see, it takes off reasonably well and quickly. During the First World War, they had a thing called the Eindecker Scourge, which was a little aeroplane which was firing machine guns through the propeller. They could creep up behind them when gunners couldn't get at them and shoot them down. So the British came up with their own idea. As they couldn't work out how to fire through the propeller without shooting it off, they decided to put the propeller behind the aeroplane and the pilot, and that's what you see. So now there's, instead of a gunner in the front, there's a machine gun, one man, and it's man against man then. But because this was, and the way they put it, very manoeuvrable, and much more manoeuvrable than the Eindecker because of the controls on it. The Eindecker used to be controlled with wing warping, and this was much more manoeuvrable because it had ailerons. And though how they said it was very manoeuvrable, I don't know. So that ended the Eindecker Scourge. But when the later German aeroplanes came along, this was much outclassed. People used to be turned loose in this for 12 hours flying. These days, in order to fly this aeroplane, somebody would have to have considerable biplane experience, because it does have some funny quirks. I mean, if you look around it, look at all the wires, it's all drag. So the whole thing is a dragmaster. And then I approach at 80 miles an hour, it stops flying at about 40. But the minute I close the throttle, the speed just drops right off. It's sort of a powered approach in it to get it to come, to get it to remain any sort of sense of control in it. It's interesting. I liked it so that children can see how aeroplanes evolved from this sort of thing to the aeroplane they sit in and go halfway around the world, and go on holiday and things. But this is the evolution of aircraft, actually. So.